morning. Good morning. We're going to flip-flop up things just a little bit here, and we're going to start by visiting. So take a moment or two to make sure you've spoken to everybody. In case you're wondering, because I'm sure you all want to know, we do have someone who just got married in October, might be over there in that area somewhere, October 21. So you might want to get by and say hi to the new Mr. and Mrs. He couldn't remember the date. He kind of hesitated, so he might be in trouble. Let's visit, and then we'll sing in a minute. Sing together. Oh, Father, we've grown up in a country that doesn't have a king. We've grown up in a country where we have the freedom to choose each and every day what we want to do, good, bad, ugly, indifferent, whatever. But Father, we need to remember that you call us to be different from that. You call us to be faithful, loyal servants, men and women who stand for what they believe in and are not afraid to share with others. Men and women, families that are willing to help those around us. Churches that all of us are leaders because each of us have been given tasks within the church, within your church. And Father, most of all, we are called to remember that you are our King, you are our Lord, you are our sovereign God. And we recognize that this morning, and we thank you for choosing us as your family. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning. Got a bunch of announcements today, so just get ready, okay? First of all, after church service this morning, we're going to decorate the church for Christmas season, okay? And we're going to have soup and sandwiches and goodies. Something happened. We were supposed to have like four or five things. I think we have closer to 45 things. So I don't know what you were planning, but if it's anything other than leftover turkey sandwich, please just stay for lunch. Oh my goodness, there's a lot of food over there, okay? Just stay for lunch, even if you can't stay afterwards to help decorate. Stay for lunch, we got plenty. The flip side of that is there's no meal this Tuesday. So you might want to sneak something out the door this morning when you leave, okay? There is Wednesday night Bible study. Advent service starts next Sunday. We're going to have special music for you a couple of times during the Christmas season. So you want to be sure and be here every Sunday, starting with Advent next Sunday, all the way through Christmas Eve evening service. Something special every service, okay? Some of you have already got yours, but out in the hall, there are Advent devotional guides, daily readings for the Christmas season. Be sure and get one of these, okay? And then everybody in your bulletin should see an order form for poinsettias. So if you're planning on donating poinsettias for the churches used for decoration, please get this filled out and get it on back to us, if you don't mind. Matter of fact, if you want to fill it out while I'm talking, you can stick it in the offering plate when it passes later. All right. Pastor wanted me to also point out that you need to be reading the book of Luke to go along with your Advent story. So watch out for that. Bunch more to go here yet. Please sign up for the memorial. You've done that. Please remember, if you're going to give mittens or gloves or scarves, we've got a mitten tree out in the lobby. Lots of ways to serve. I'm not really sure how this made our schedule, but apparently on December 10th, we're having an ugly Christmas sweater competition. So y'all want to be sure and be here with your fine, 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 ugly sweater on, okay? Whatever. On December 7th, our Sunday school class is having a Christmas party. So if you're connected to them in any way or want to be a part of it, reach out to Maren Hubble and we'll work out the details on that. Oh, your offering envelopes. If you use offering envelopes each week, they're out in the table, out in the lobby. So you can be sure to pick up one of those. I think I've caught all my announcements. Do y'all have other announcements? Yes. This Wednesday? Okay, good. Thank you. Any other announcements? All right, let's sing our next song. Thank you.
Would the kids like to come up this morning? Just have a seat there. I will be there in just a second. I'll come around this way. We're getting full. That's great. So nice to see all you guys this morning. How's everybody doing? Everybody doing good? You have a good Thanksgiving? You can come over here. You can come over here. You don't have to go over there. Come on over here and sit. Come on over here and sit. That way, yeah, that way you can see what I'm doing. Okay? Hi. I'm going to show you some pictures. Who is this? Huh? Who is that? Fire. It's a fireman, isn't it? How can you tell he's a fireman? Because he's got a helmet on and he's got a fire suit. Yeah, so we know what a fireman is by the way they dress, don't we? Who's that? A cowboy, that's right, because he's got a big hat on. And he's got cowboy boots and spurs. He might even be a sheriff. Okay, go. Who's that? That's a police officer, that's right, because he has a blue uniform and a badge and a hat. This one's even got a whistle in his mouth. Who's that? This one might be harder. Who's that? A baker. Yeah, because he wears a baking hat. He wears a chef's hat. He's got an apron on. Okay, who's that? A king? Might be Burger King. I don't know. But it's a king. How do you know he's a king? You know he's Burger King? He might be. He's got a crown, and he's got a robe. Yeah, so he's a king. Now, huh? Oh, might have, yeah, that's why he's got his robe on, because he just got out of the bath. That could be too. Okay, who's this? Jesus. You notice Jesus has a crown on, just like a king? Today is Jesus Christ the King Sunday. It's when we celebrate Jesus is a king. Now, Jesus is not like other kings. He's different. And Jesus isn't one that we see that we can go and he has a court, but we want Jesus to be in a special place. And Jesus wants to be not king of this world, but he wants to be the king in our heart. So today at this service, whenever we have Jesus the king, we're going to invite Jesus into our heart. And that's the important place where Jesus wants to be. Okay? Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we have all of these people and we know that all of them wear different hats. And we can tell who they are by what they wear and how they are. Lord, we want to invite Christ to be our king. That he wears the king and the robe and the crown, the Lord, that you gave him, that our Father in heaven gave him. And today he sits at the right hand of God the Father. Lord, today I ask you to bless these kids and to let them know that Christ is the king. But not a king of a normal world, but a king of their heart and a king of their life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, you guys want some candy today? Oops, there they go. What do you want? You want an M&M or something else? Oh, there we go. You like suckers, I think. I'm going to have to put some more suckers in for you. There you go, guys. Oops. There we go. Okay, thank you. Everybody get something? Okay, guys, have a good day at Children's Church.
I got the one you dropped on the floor.
Did you? Okay. What a blessing it is to have the kids up here and to have them worship with us and to have them worship in Children's Church. Joys and concerns. Anybody have a big week this week? Anything going on this week in your lives? Yeah. Okay. How many birthday? Oh my goodness. Happy birthday. I'm going to have to really start paying attention to the newsletter when they send it out with all the birthdays on it. They're sneaking up on me. I've got to start marking my calendar. Everett, you've got your hand up back there. You've got to talk really loud.
Can you pray for my cousins because their parents just got divorced?
Amanda, you're going to have to help me.
He would like you to pray for his cousins because their parents just got divorced.
Okay, definitely. Thank you, Everett. Anybody else? Any other joys this morning? Yes.
We got to celebrate Thanksgiving 3 days in a row.
Are you tired of turkey yet? Any other joys? Any other joys? Any
Michigan
other?
Michigan beat Ohio State.
Joys, concerns. Anybody we need to lift up? Yes. We'll lift her up in prayers. Anybody else? Yes?
A friend of mine, Troy, is in his last days of hospice.
Okay. We'll keep Troy in our prayers also. Anybody else? Any other joys? Any other concerns? Yes, Gary?
Well, it ain't snowing here like Chicago's getting.
That's right. That's right. That's why we live down south.
They're up to the morning door.
Yes. Oh, yes, Jim.
Birthday.
Another birthday?
Yeah, birthday.
How many?
79.
All right. Happy birthday.
We have a joy too. We've been celebrating for 2 weeks of David's birthday, which is December 1st, and he's already been celebrating for 2 weeks.
I've got a joy that every Sunday I get to see new people, and it's nice to have people visiting and worshiping with us. Thank you for all being here. Yes?
So last week was collection week for the shoe boxes for Samaritan's Purse, and Monday I was invited to go down to Darmstadt to Trinity Lutheran Church, and we loaded about 1,000 of the big boxes, which had 15 shoe boxes in each box. So if you think about that number a minute, 15,000, and that's just one collectional, regional collection site. And there's many more sites like that headed to Boone, North Carolina. From there, they'll go overseas. So that was a big win for Samaritan's Purse and all of you that helped by packing a shoebox.
Amen. Kind of shows what one small seed can do, doesn't it? Amen. Anybody else? If not, would you go to the Lord in prayer with me? Lord, this morning as we come, Lord, as we come to your altar in prayer, as we bow our heads quietly, as we listen to God's voice, Lord, let us send up praises to you. As we come, let us praise God for all that he has done, that opened our eyes, that we are thankful this week. And Lord, let us go forward being thankful. And let us look forward to the season of Advent and the birth of Jesus Christ. And as today, as we celebrate Christ the King Sunday, let us know that Christ is the King and wants to be the King of our lives. Lord, guide and direct us. We lift up all of the joys of birthdays that we have and the celebration of families that have been had. But Lord, we lift up those concerns. The concerns of those that are sick, the concerns that are those that have passed and the families that are left. And the concerns of those that are sick and that are maybe in their last days. Lord, we ask that you would reach out. That as they have been lifted up today, that you will touch those people. That you will touch those families that love them. And to send your healing powers upon them. Lord, be with all of us today in our service. As we lift up our praises to you, as we sing this morning to all of the things, and we read God's word, Lord, this morning we praise you and we thank you And as we pray and thank you, Lord, we pray as you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We always have a time in our service that we're able to not only give thanks to God and to praise him, but we're able to monetarily give our gifts to God as all that he has given to us. Would the ushers please come forward as we have our morning offering? from Philippians 4:4. It says, rejoice. Always rejoice in the Lord. Again, I say rejoice. When we do that, shouldn't that be the way that we would come to worship? Not just this Sunday, and maybe not just Christmas Day as we look for the baby in the altar, and not just in the manger, and not just on Easter Sunday when Christ is risen. Those are wonderful Sundays to come and to rejoice. But what about if we would every morning rejoice? Rejoice in the Lord Jesus Christ. What if we made Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior? Every breath we take, we praise the name of Jesus. That is making Jesus Christ not just a king, but the king. The king of your heart. The king of your life. Church calendars don't seem to fall with the calendars of the rest of the year. If you're looking at the church calendar, today would be New Year's Eve Sunday. It's the last Sunday of this year. It is our last Sunday to try to figure out who Jesus Christ really is before we start looking for him in the manger next week. Christ the King Sunday has not always been on this Sunday. It used to be at the end of October, and it was right before All Saints Day was Christ the King Sunday. But in 1969, Pope Paul VI decided to change. And he put it on this Sunday, the Sunday of the last of the year. And if you wonder where this Sunday came from, maybe you haven't heard of it very much. It has always been Christ, the feast of Christ the King. Today we kind of shorten it down and we just call it Christ the King Sunday. It is a day that we come and we worship a king. When we worship Jesus Christ as our king, and you worship Jesus Christ as your king. When you think of kings, we don't have a lot of kings in our country, in our world today. It's not something that is seen very much, that very few governments had. But in the time of Jesus, there were kings. And the kings ruled. So at that time, the people of Israel, the Jewish people of Israel, looked for a king. They looked for a king to come and to save them, to give them freedom, to end the Roman oppression that they had, and to break their slavery. But see, they were looking for a different king than what God had in mind. God had in mind of a spiritual king. A king, yes, that would give them freedom. A king that would end their slavery. But not a king of slavery of what we think of in this world, but a slavery to sin and death, and to give us freedom of eternal life. Today, the world wants to diminish, much as it did back in the time of Jesus, of the King Jesus Christ. They want to tell us that he is not the King of all kings. And they want to take away Jesus' kingship. And they want us to instead focus, not upon focus of reaffirming Jesus Christ and to respect his power and authority of his heavenly kingdom, but they are telling us to look at the kingdom of this world and to fall upon that. But the scriptures all seem to tell us of a different thing, of a different king. So this morning, we need to focus. We need to focus our life on Jesus Christ. We need to look at the scriptures and see where Jesus is as our king, different than what we think of a normal king. Jesus wants to navigate our lives. He wants to help us out, because in many times, all of us, in many times, we get lost. We kind of get off course. And Jesus is going to spiritually navigate our lives whenever we have no idea where we're going. So Jesus tells us that he is the king, but he is not the king, but also the way. The way to eternal salvation. Jesus does not say, I am a way, that there are many ways, many paths. There are many gods that can take you into salvation, but Jesus says, I am the way. So Jesus is not just a king, but he is the king. He is our Savior. And he calls us to follow his rule and to recognize that Jesus is the King of Kings, the Messiah, the Lord, the Savior, the Bread of Life. All of these names are Jesus Christ. In John 8:12, it says that Jesus is the light of the world. And whoever follows will not walk in darkness, but have that light. I want to look at a scripture this morning. And I told you last week, as you read the Psalms, as you read them and let them soak into you, look at Psalms 97. And if your eyes kind of look over to verse into 96 or 98, that's okay. Those are also about praising Jesus. But look at Psalms 97. It says, the Lord is King. Let the earth rejoice. Let many coastlands be glad. The heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all the people behold his glory. As I look at this and I see this, I see a lot of things in my life, but I also see something. I want to pull out a new hymnal, but this was also in an old hymnal. And in the new hymnal, this is on page 277, and the title of this song, which was written by Charles Wesley in 1746. And Charles Wesley talks about a king. And he talks about Jesus, the king. Here is the first verse. Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Rejoice, give thanks, and sing the triumph forevermore. Lift up your hearts. Lift up your voice. Rejoice. I say rejoice. Charles Wesley wrote many, many hymns and songs. This is an excellent song of Christ the King. And it sings of who Jesus is. Jesus is our Lord of Lords. He is our King. So my question this morning as we come, my challenge to you to think about in Christ the King, is, can you push away all of the other things of the world? Can you push away your own pride and your own things that you do not trust that Jesus is there with you? And can you take Jesus and make him the true king? Not the king of this world, the king of the heavenly kingdom. Can you say, Jesus is my king? Can you profess that? And when should we make Jesus our king? This morning I want to show you in some scriptures and make Jesus the reason that we worship, the reason that we come here every Sunday is to worship and to praise Jesus Christ, our King.
Amen.
Psalms 97, another psalm, celebrate Jesus, the enthronement of a King over all creation. In the opening verses of Psalms 97, it talks about Yahweh is the creator of everything. Because of God's righteousness, of Judah and Israel, rejoice in the confidence of the world. But the church looks at Psalms 97, and you could look at this and consider this to be a bridge. Not just of the Old Testament, not just of Yahweh, of God of all creation, but of Jesus Christ. Because it tells you in John 1 that in the beginning, the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And on Christ the King Sunday, such images should remain with us that the kingship of Jesus Christ, not the baby in the manger, but the man that went to the cross, that embodied God, that was 100% human and 100% God, that was truly God and man, and that today still lives and rules in justice and righteousness and causes the angels in heaven to sing. The next scripture I want to have you look at is from Colossians 1. Now, I wrote down 11 to 20, but I want to focus on just a couple of verses in here, a few verses. Verse 15 says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in Him all things in heaven and earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones nor dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through Him and for Him. I want you to look, and there's one word in there, the firstborn. It doesn't do that for a status. It is not a status of where Jesus sits as the King. That's not what it's for. But it is to let you know that Jesus was before anything. And Paul wants to make a radical shift here and let you know that as he's sorting out, as Paul is dealing with people that are trying to diminish the kingdom of God, he is saying, yes, there's other powers in the universe, but there is a King and there is one King, and that King is Jesus Christ. He is the firstborn, that He is not created. He was with God in the beginning. And as we see this, we lift up God because we know that Jesus is above all powers. And then Paul goes back, and I took this out of order, because Paul goes back, and if you go back to 13, before he tells us, he says that He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into a kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. Not only is Jesus the firstborn, but Jesus is a Savior. He came and saved us from something that nobody else could do. He came and gave us redemption of a life of death and gave us a life for everything. And He forgave all of our sins, because He paid a price that nobody else could pay. He rescued us from a problem that seems to be that man has, and that's sin. And He gave us forgiveness. We don't want to forget. There's a couple of words in there that we really don't want to forget. That we all sin and we all fall short. But Jesus Christ paid a ransom to Satan. And then we need to remember in there also is forgiveness. You are forgiven. Your debt has been canceled. Your balance is zero. Jesus Christ came because of our sinfulness. And he came to give us redemption and freedom and forgiveness. God's forgiveness of sinners is an act of grace. Now, grace is not something that we'd go on and gives us an excuse to sin. But as we see as the unforgiving servant, and made it clear that unforgiving leads us to bondage. So we need forgiveness to have that freedom. You remember back when I said that whenever the people of Israel, when Jesus came, and they thought Jesus was going to be their king, and they wanted him to be a king of this earth to give them freedom of slavery? Well, Jesus is that. He gives us a freedom of slavery. He transfers all of our sin to him. And Jesus brings us into the light. Jesus is the preeminent in salvation. Nobody else can do this but Jesus. And it says, he himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head and the body of the church. He is the beginning. Jesus is the head of the church. But as you are baptized and you become part of that body, not someday, you become part of that body that day, that moment. You are part of Christ's family. You are part of the body. If you look in Ephesians, it tells you that you are adopted into the family of Christ. Wouldn't it be great to be adopted? If you're adopted, you're not just born. You know, when my mom and dad had me, they had to take me home. The hospital said they had to. Because I was born to them. But if you're adopted, you're chosen. Christ chose you to be part of his family. That's amazing, to be adopted into the family of Christ. And for him and all the fullness, God pleased to dwell. And through him, God was pleased to reconcile himself to all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of the cross. Colossians 1 is a wonderful place to make a case that Jesus Christ is not just a prophet. Jesus Christ cannot be diminished, but his status as the creator of all things, the firstborn, is simply put that the status of importance, that we know that Jesus Christ is God himself in the flesh. And Peter goes further, that Christ created all things. But there's those in the world that want to make Christ less. And if you think of the kings that were in the time of Jesus, they all failed. Look what Jeremiah says. All of the kings, and you have to preference this with Jeremiah, what his writing here is, but all of the kings that were up to that, they all failed. They all either turned away from God or they put their center on self. But in Jeremiah 23, he writes this, "Then I myself will gather the remnant of thy flock out of the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to the fold where they shall be fruitful and apply and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall no longer fear or be dismayed, nor shall they be missing says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will rise up a branch of David, a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. Jeremiah writes, as the people are in exile, that God will bring his people back to him. And he will give them a king. We know that happened. We know that Jesus Christ was born in a manger. We know that Jesus Christ grew and prophesied and healed as he lived upon this earth. We know that Jesus Christ went to the cross. And we know he rose from the dead. And then he ascended into heaven. God's still working. God's not done. God's still drawing his people back. There is a righteous branch and there is a king. And that king is Jesus Christ. So I want you to consider this. I came to church for many years. I grew up in the church. I went to church many times. But it's that time that you take the challenge. When you say, yes, I know Jesus, I know the Holy Spirit. But today, open up your hearts. Maybe you've done it before, but our challenge is over and over again to commit and recommit, to repent and to come back, because we keep falling short. We are working towards perfection, but we are not there. So our challenge is to open our hearts and our lives to Jesus Christ. To say, yes, I know Jesus. But Jesus, I want to know you and let you be the king of my life. Revelation 17, 16 says that Jesus is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. These old words only make sense when you let Christ into your life, when you make him your personal Savior. And Jesus told us our kingdom is not of this world. This is what Daniel writes. And I saw one like a human being coming with the clouds of heaven. And he came to the Ancient One and was presented before him. To him was given a dominion over the glory and the kingship. All the peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion was everlasting dominion that shall not pass away. His kingship is one that shall never be destroyed. From the Old Testament to the rest of the story to the revelations at the end that is still coming. Jesus Christ is our King. But we need to take this and we need to do and to listen and to take God into our hearts. We need to accept a challenge. We need to leave here this morning that Jesus Christ is our challenge. And we need to commit to that and to walk weekly with him. David asked God to search his heart and to reveal to him anything that was not of God within him, to make Christ the Lord of our lives. We need to do the same. First, invite Christ into your life. Repent and invite Christ into your heart. Maybe you have never done that before. Maybe you have done it and we need to do it again. This, good people, is personal. This is not as a group thing in a church. This is personal. This is to you over here. This is to me. It's in our lives. It's a commitment. It says that we are going to push everything else away in the world And we're going to put our total trust in Jesus. Make Jesus king, the king of all creation. Most important, make Jesus the king of your heart. Let him rule your heart. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you this morning for this Sunday that we come and we get a focus and remember that Jesus Christ is the king. He's the king of all creation, but he's also the king of all that has been made. Jesus is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And this morning I ask that, yes, you will refresh in our hearts and our minds. Deliver us from putting other idols in front before you and make you the king of our lives, the center of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go out and have a good week this week. And I want to invite you to, we start into Advent next week. We're going to start next week with hope. But I want you to rediscover Christmas. Rediscover Christmas in the hope of Jesus Christ. Have a blessed week. Thank you for being here. Enjoy decorating today and eating together. I encourage you, all of you, to go back and get some soup. And have a wonderful Sunday together. And then as we move into Advent, make Christ the center of your Christmas. In Jesus' name, amen.